Again and again, good morning to everyone. We are experimenting with technology this morning. We have gone live in YouTube. And so now, you can clap, And so it will not be on, so everything that's on Facebook is coming from YouTube. So it's going to be a little off, you know, if you're watching us live. So those of you who normally watch us live on Facebook, it's going to take you to YouTube. So just let you know about that. But today we want to finish our sermon from last week as we talked about walking in fellowship. And this is part two. Second Sunday. This is our second Sunday of this new sermon series, Life After Easter, Being the Church in a Messy World. Anybody watch the news this week? And did you have to breathe through it? I'm just saying. As we look at the news on all platforms, we still see the world is still crazy. It's getting worse instead of better. We see all the people shooting and just the other day, the murder, a lady, I saw in the news, somebody in broad daylight came and hijacked her at the light and took the car. Lord, bind us together in Christian love. It seems like humanity has lost its mind. And it seems that the body of Christ has forgotten who they're supposed to be. We've forgotten that our true call is to be brothers and sisters knitted together by the blood of Jesus and our faith that he is the risen Lord. With Jesus as the head, we are called to be the body of Christ. But if you look at Christians today and what they're writing and what they're saying, it looks like the body has schizophrenia. We are double-minded. If you talk to one, it doesn't sound like they're in harmony with each other. We are being called to repent. Be converted. We need a new conversion. The Christian faith, the body of Christ need a new conversion because people have forgotten what it means to be Christian. It's about being the body of Christ. Knitted together in a common love. Those who are followers of Jesus are commanded to be in fellowship with one another and creation. Let us pray. Love will come to perfection in us when we can face the day of judgment without fear, because our relation to this world is just like Christ. Oh Lord, help us to hear your word and be doers of the command to be and bring light into the darkness where we are. May the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Let me decrease and you increase. Give them ears to hear and a heart to understand. This we pray in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. This morning, we are continuing our sermon from last week, Walking in Fellowship. And it's coming from 1 John 1, 1 through 4, the New Revised Standard Version, the updated edition from last week. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. What we have seen and heard, we also declare to you so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that your joy may be complete. Walking. Last week we talked about walking, one spiritual and moral journey. The gospel writer, Apostle John, writes a pastoral letter to the new generation of believers who are walking the light, the life, supposedly, so they will have assurance and confidence in God and in their faith. First John was written to dispel doubts and to build assurance by presenting a clear picture of Jesus Christ. John, the revelator, the beloved, knew the Christ. He had lived with him and had seen Jesus work. John enjoyed the fellowship with the Father and the Son during his days living on earth. He explains in simple terms what it means to have fellowship with God. False teachers with different understanding of Jesus then and now had entered into the assembly denying the incarnation of Christ. John writes to correct the errors, and I'm preaching, help me, Lord, to correct the errors of the doctrine that has been taught. John begins his letter giving his credentials as an eyewitness of the incarnation and by stating his reason for writing this letter. John presents to us today how we as believers, the body of Christ and disciples of our risen Savior and Lord, can have fellowship with God through our faith in Jesus. John is showing us that whoever claims to live in Jesus must walk spiritually and morally as Jesus walked. Walk. Walking literally to travel. But I want to talk about how we live, how we behave. What is our conduct? If I see you on the street and you don't see me, how are you acting? If we see you at the stoplight, what are you doing? If I'm walking in the mall, literally, and you're there, can I tell that you're a member of the church? What are people saying about you? What does your neighbor say? I'm literally giving space so that you can think about it. If I walked to your neighbor's house and knocked on the door and asked about you, what would they say about you? Would I hear that you are a disciple of Jesus Christ? They see it on you. They hear it from your lips, and you truly are part of the movement of God. Or would they say you look like them and you act like them? I don't mean other, come on. In the New Testament, Paul reminds the congregation in Colossae to not walk as they once did in the ways determined by man's earthly sin nature. If we walk as Jesus did, we will live in fellowship with the Father through our faith in Jesus as our risen Lord. Walking as Jesus brings us into fellowship. Fellowship is in the Greek is koinonia. Holding our lives and if we are the body of Christ, we hold each other in common. As last week I said, it's more than socializing. It's not about a muffin and a cup of coffee. If that's all you come for, go meet at Starbucks or sip. It's more than that. It's about coming together, learning from one another, holding each other accountable. This is done through spiritual, social, and material generosity towards one another. How can you say you love Christ when who you don't see, and you can't love me who you see, and you say you're a Christian? How can you say you hate me? Hate your brethren, hate your sister, hate, and all of you, whether you in the Methodist church, Baptist church, coming around the corner, Lutheran, non-denominations, throwing up the hand, Jesus Christ. Koinonia is a common sharing of grace and of the blessings of God and community. We gain strength, support, and protection from the world's woes when we are in true fellowship. Apostle John's writings let us know that when we are in fellowship with the Father and the Son, we can walk in fellowship with all creation. When we connected with the source, we're going to talk about that next week. When we're connected with the source, there is no reason to be out of fellowship with one another. Walking in fellowship means walking in harmony with God. You heard from Psalm 133 how wonderful and pleasant it is when brothers live together in what? Say that word with me. Harmony. For harmony is precious as the anointed oil that was poured over Aaron's head, that ran down his beard and onto the border of his robe. Harmony is as refreshing as the dew from Mount Hermon that falls on the mountains of Zion, and where the Lord has pronounced his blessings, even life everlasting. Do you see that blessings come when you are in harmony? The Bible says, we like to quote, some of us that know Bible, like to say that blessings come down upon us. But blessings cannot come if we're not in harmony with one another. Given it shall be given back to you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall your brethren give unto your bosom. So how can your brethren give if we are not in harmony? Wow. To do all of this, we must walk with God. Walk in harmony in God's light. Walking in fellowship is walking in agreement with God's ways and God's commands. Walking in harmony is based on us walking in agreement. Do you agree with what God says? And some of us don't. Amen. Let's just stick with the new covenant. Jesus said you only have two commands to live: to love God with your whole being and love your neighbor as yourself. That takes up all the Ten Commandments. You don't even have to separate them. If you love God and in walking in harmony with God, I don't care who you see outside, it's going to cause you to have compassion on them. You don't hear me. Whether they're Buddhist, Hindu, male, female, Jew, or Greek. So that's why we don't want to murder anybody. Watch that. We don't want to steal from anybody. Because God doesn't do that, so why would we? Anybody catching this? That we say we hate because this is said in the Old Testament, but Jesus says we to what? Love. Everybody. Did he say everybody or did he just say certain people? No, it must have said certain people, because we got Christians walking around hating other human beings. It must have just said people who walk with a duck walk. I'm just saying, I don't know, because for some reason, humanity and Christians have decided They can hate who God loves. Oh, I'm preaching today. Woo! So how can we say we hate the Iranians, or we hate the Buddhists, or we hate Black people, or we hate Caucasian people, or we hate Native American, or we hate LGBTQ, or we hate something this, or we hate something that? How can we say that when we say we're Christians walking in harmony with God? And we the church, the body of Christ, with Jesus as the head. Jesus is the head, and Jesus said, love them to me. So then how the hate gonna get them to love Jesus? Are you tracking this? I can't treat you wrong and then say, hey, come to church. I can't talk about you and scandalize your name, but then I want you to come and be Jesus and come and find Jesus. Turn my nose up to the homeless if I can't even walk to them and give them love that Jesus has sent them. Or the drug dealer, anybody hearing this? Again, walking in harmony is based on us walking in agreement with God. What did God say? I think the problem is many people don't know what God said. They know what they think God said, but hadn't read the word. They know what somebody else said to them. Come on here. Preachers preaching it. Preachers preaching non-love. Preachers preaching non-harmony. Preachers preaching not being in agreement. And so I'm going to go and tell it because my preacher said it, so it got to be true. But what did God say? Oh, I'm getting excited. Please calm down. Fellowship is maintained with God as we continue walking in the light of God that God reveals unto us. Jesus shows it quickly. He says in his word, the law said, but I tell you now. That means it's a change, right? The law says, but I tell you now, which means, yeah, it was said in the law, but now there's a new covenant. There's a new agreement. We still living on the old agreement, and God got a new agreement through the blood of Jesus Christ. So what happens when this happens? Galatians 6. What happens when people don't walk in agreement? What are we supposed to do when we see someone or someone is coming up against and we'll not walk in fellowship? You heard in the reading, Galatians 6, 1 through 3 from the Passion Translation. My beloved friends, if you see a believer, we're talking about church folks now. So y'all sit, we're sitting, y'all, us. I went Southern on you, didn't I? We, you. We sit and we let those who say they're Christians, they're in our denominations, they're in the Christian fold, they say they're Christian, and we listen to their foolishness and we won't say anything. Say ouch. I remember in a church, one lady was in Arizona. Oh my God. She caused everyone to just walk on eggshells. And so I went to one of her peers and said, why haven't you said that? Oh, we know her. She had this life. And so we just look over her. You let your friend be wrong and cause division and confusion in her family and in her church family because you're like, oh, that's how she is. Paul says to the church of Galatia, my beloved friends, if you see a believer who is overtaken with a fault, the one who is in the spirit should seek to restore him in the spirit of gentleness. If you say you're in the spirit, then you should be able to walk and speak truth in love, in compassion, not haughty and in judgmental, but in compassion, because you want your brother to walk in what? Harmony. But it says, it warns you, but keep watch over your own heart so that you won't be tempted to exalt yourself over him. Don't be walking in judgment. Don't be looking at the speck in his eye or her eye and you got a big plank in yours. Love empowers us to fulfill the law of the anointed one as we carry each other's troubles. If you think you are somebody too important to stoop down to help another, when really you are not, you are living in deception. My God, that's scripture. Galatians 6, 1 through 3, you heard that. Walking in harmony with God. It's a common sharing of grace and the blessings of God in community. Last week, we demonstrated that being in fellowship is like making music. We're not going to try to demonstrate that today because we still don't have a person who can do harmony. In a musical production, everyone must not only play the correct notes, but they must also be playing in the same key. Remember last week? Each of us are called to be playing in the key of God. God's key, a melodious sound that surrounds us. Do you know the birds know how to play, how to sing in the key of God? The trees know how to sing in the key of God. Grass knows. You ever listen, ever been in the woods and just hear the grass knows how to play in the key of God? The animals know how to play in the key of God, but humanity, who was made in the image of God, has forgotten the key. Woo! I got to get out of here. Fellowship is burning me up. Fellowship. Learning and being one with God and one with each other builds unity. Unity is having things in common. I'm not talking about uniformity. You don't have to put the same color on or wear the same top and pants or have the same opinion. That's not unity. God didn't make us to look alike. Look around you. They do say I favor my mom, but I still was not my mother. You may look like your sister or brother, but you're not your sister or brother. But we're to be what? In unity. Unity is having things in common. Just illustration. Let me help you out. Okay, after worship, we all going to the movies at Franklin Mall. Can we all agree? Just pretend, just say yes. Can we all agree that we all going to the movie? Hey, we need to do that. We need to all go to the movies after service. We all going to the movie and we going to Franklin Mall. Everybody in here knows where Franklin Mall is, right? And if you don't have a car, you pick somebody and you can just drive, just jump in one of our cars and we all going to the movie. Now we got 5 cars going. Everybody's in the car. And we're going to the movies. But how many know there's different ways to get to Franklin Mall from here? Watch this. Unity. We all going to the what? Huh? Unity, we all going where? To the mall. But we're not in uniformity because many of us may choose different routes to get there. I may go, what's that? West on Reynolds west on Hill and north on Reynolds and cut across east on Central and hit Talmadge and go south. Somebody else may go what is that way? East on Hill and north on Richard, and go straight across and make and go west and then turn and go up Talmadge. Then somebody may say, well, I don't want to go any other way. I'm going to go the long way around and go all the way up to Holland, Sylvania and come back. You see, we are in harmony about where we are going, but we may each decide how do we get there. We're still in unity. Same key. Let's stop trying to make everybody look like us. And be on the same key. Have common, sharing common being, sharing the grace and the blessings of God, being in community. So today, I know I got out of character today. No, I really didn't. I got a little excited about this today. Walking in fellowship and harmony is truly what we need to strive for. Fellowship is about learning how we have things in common and sharing those things with others. It is our bound duty as followers of Jesus. If we are striving to be good Christians, thus we strive for harmony to walk in fellowship. The Apostle Paul appealed to the congregations in Ephesus and to us today. Let us hear what Paul is saying to us from Ephesians 4, 1 through 6, the Amplified Bible Classic Edition. I, therefore, the prisoner for the Lord, appeal to and beg you to walk. Remember, we talk about walking. Lead a life worthy of the divine calling to which you have been called. Wait a minute. I don't remember being called. Well, how you think you became a Christian? Didn't Jesus call his disciples to come? You're not just a Christian because you just showed up. You're just a church person if you just showed up. But you're a Christian, you're a called. With behavior that is a credit to the summons of God's service. You want to know if a true Christian, they know they got to work for God. Summons, I like that word. Summons is deep. You know, when the court sends a summons, you got to show up or you going to what? Jail. God's summons, that is a credit to the summons that God called you. Living as becomes you. With complete lowliness of mind. So how you want to know you're walking in him, walking in harmony? You have humility and meekness, which is unselfishness, gentleness, and mildness. If you selfish, you want it all about you, or you know someone is my way or the highway, there's no harmony and there's no fellowship. How can you be in fellowship with someone who's always about them? We're to be with patience. Patience means the capacity to tolerate pain and suffering and foolishness sometimes without getting frustrated and angry. Bearing with one another. And making allowances because you love one another. That you want them to succeed. So you try to what? Help them. Be eager and strive earnestly to God and keep the harmony and oneness of and produced by the Spirit in the binding power of peace. As I was saying to my worship, I said, people always want to keep peace. You cannot keep peace. If you try to keep peace in your family, you're wrong. Peace is a spirit. How you keep a spirit? And a spirit is like the wind. But you can make peace. In the binding power of peace. There is one body and one spirit, just as there is also one hope that belongs to the calling you receive. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is above all, sovereign over all, pervading all, and living in us all. This is the agreement that we should walk in. This is the agreement. So walking in koinonia, as I've in this message, means growing in harmony with all God's creation around us. It means growing in harmony with one another. It means working at it. It just doesn't happen. Did you notice when we went to strive to try to do that key last week, we had to work on that thing to make sure we were singing in the right key. It is work as good Christians, as the body of Christ. It takes work for us to be in harmony with one another. Just because you love Jesus doesn't mean that you're going to walk in harmony. You got to work at it. Just like marriage, you have to work at it. Good marriages doesn't come. If you ask a couple that's been married over 50 years, they're going to tell you they worked at it. They had to share things in common and agree to disagree to those things that would divide them. As we seek to be and live in agreement with God and Jesus, we must grow to maturity, spiritually, then emotionally. I just want to help someone. Let me tell you how you know you're growing spiritually. It's when you mentally and emotionally grow up. If you're still acting like a child in your emotions, your spirituality is not growing. Because as you grow in God, you automatically grow up in Him. We are called to obtain the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. So I invite you today to prepare your hearts if you're not, and if you have, to even prepare even more to check your fellowship with God. And how are you harmonizing with those who call, like, just like you, to the body of Christ? And many times we know we miss the mark of walking in the key of God. And when we miss the mark walking in the key of God, then we miss the mark walking in the key of each other. We can agree to disagree, but we still must walk in the key of God. So I call you today to confession, to repentance. Turn to God if your heart is heavy. Invite Christ to lighten the load if your heart is hardened. Invite the Spirit to soften and change you. If you know you've been having problems to love someone, right now is the time. If you can't love black, white, blue, green, red, yellow, male, female, LGBTQ, non-LGBTQ, people who don't think like you, people who think like you, if you can't, today is the day to ask God to come and change your heart. Truly, we all need to receive God's grace and to heed Christ's call. So right now, this is your time to search your heart, search your emotions, search your mental well-being. Ask God to search you. And if God find anything that's not in the key of God, to help you fine tune. I meant to get a tuning fork. Ding. So that we all can go with God. This is your time to pray in silence. And those who are online, this is your time to search your heart. Are you walking in hatred? Or strong dislike, as some people want to say? Are you walking out of fellowship with God? This is your time to say, I yield. come into my heart, oh God, renewing me a right spirit. Wash me. Cleanse me. If this is you today, I summons you to throw your hands up and say, I yield. Be pliable and flexible so that God, through faith in Jesus Christ, and if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, this is your time to ask Jesus to come in and bring the Holy Spirit to baptize you with fire. We are praying for you who are online today as we pray for ourselves. We pray for the world. Everyone, let us pray in unison. God of love and compassion, we often fail to understand the truth of your love. We are frequently confused and filled with doubt. Life can feel meaningless. We wander down the pathways of life, longing to see our way more clearly. Open our eyes this day that we may see your way of love and grace. Meet our confusion with the truth of your presence. Feed us with the true bread of life and help us change our hearts and lives that we may follow you with joy. Amen. God's promises are for us. By the power of the Holy Spirit, God invites us into newness of life, forgiving and blessing us, everyone. Thanks be to God. Our great thanksgiving for Easter. May God walk beside you. Let us hearts rejoice in God. Hallelujah. God is good. Let us thank and praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We will thank and praise God forever. We praise you, living God, for you are the source of all life and goodness. You call the world into being, atoms and molecules dancing into life in harmony. In the glorious springtime, the seeds of your grace flourish. Thank you for new life, from blooming flowers to the new hope rising within our hearts. You created humanity and set us in a world of abundance. Yet, we turn from others and forget to turn to you. Through the ages, you sent prophets like Peter, who told people to change their hearts and lives. Your love for us never failed. We listened to the heavens as they declare your glory with whirling stars, gentle showers, and sunshine, all in harmony with the birds singing and the crickets chirping. And so we join their song along with the earthly chorus of robins, frogs, children, and people everywhere, everyone together. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Alleluia. Blessed is the one who guides our steps. Alleluia. Blessed is the one who listens and saves. Alleluia. You, O God, chose Jesus from the beginning. He came to walk beside us, teaching us your ways, healing what was broken. He opened our eyes to see your love in the world, yet his very being threatened the powers of the world. He was crucified, died, and laid in a tomb. In 3 days, the tomb was emptied and Jesus was alive. On his last night with friends, Jesus took the bread, blessed it, and gave it to them. This is the bread of life, the very presence of the risen Christ. Then he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it to them. This is the cup of the new covenant, overflowing with forgiveness. At the table in Emmaus, Jesus again took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his walking companions, revealing his living presence. As we remember these things, we are grateful for love and new life. We are yours, and we will walk with you. We remember that the stranger we met on the road was Jesus. We will remember that even while we are walking, we still may meet Jesus and not even know it. Help us, oh God, to see him and listen as he breaks bread with us, revealed unto us, even now in this meal. And so we proclaim the mystery of faith, everyone. Christ has died, was crucified and buried. Christ is risen and is teaching his love. Christ will come again to walk beside us. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon this community and the community that is watching us online. And upon these gifts of bread and cup, may they be the living presence of Jesus, feeding us with the presence of Christ in the world. By your Spirit, guide our steps that we may serve you. We praise you. We thank you. You are our God, and we walk in harmony with you and one another. Amen. And amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray the pattern of prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us all pray our prayer of thanksgiving, everyone. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our benediction. As you walk in the paths of life, know that Jesus is with you, blessing you with his presence. Go forth as witnesses of the blessings of our God. Amen. And those who can and will stand and will sing three verses of Blessed Be the Tie That Binds, hymn number 557.